instructors, Professor Kim here. I've got another great game that you can bring into your classroom and share with your students. This one focuses on history, geography, and teaching students context. The first game is Timeline. Timeline asks students to historically put into context events, inventions, discoveries, items, music. There are so many genres of boxes that you can get that focus your attention on particular aspects of history. The game that teaches students about geography in addition to history is called Cardline. Cardline asks the same thing of students, putting these countries into context regarding four different categories. I will go into more detail with both of these games in my instructor tutorial as well as my student tutorial. So stick around. Before I jump into how to play Timeline, I just want to address that there's a really great Timeline Challenge game. It plays up to 10 players and makes more of a strategy game out of this base game that I'm going to be teaching you today. Another thing I'd like to mention is this is the inventions box. And yes, it does thematically cover a lot of genres within inventions, but you also have different tints like music and cinema, diversity, historical events, inventions, discoveries. Please check out this website to learn more about all the different timeline versions you can bring into your classroom. Hey instructors, I've got the game set up on the table and I'm ready to teach you. There are two sides to these cards. One side has an image and a name of an invention. The back side has the same things, but it also has a color-coded date. You need to make sure that all of the cards are facing down with the dates hidden. If you have 2 to 3 players, each player will deal themselves date side down, 6 cards. 4 to 5 players, 5 cards, and then 6 to 8 players each get 4 cards. I have this set up for a 4-player game, and the last thing you do before you start is you flip over one card from the top of the deck, date side up. This is our start date. Essentially, we are going to be placing our cards one turn at a time, either in front of or behind the card that already exists. Our timeline is going to grow and grow and grow until one player has played all of their cards successfully into the timeline. Let's say I'm the first player. I look at the center card and I say, hot air balloon, 1783. I get to look at all 5 of my cards and then decide which one of these do I want to place into the timeline. I will then take that card. This says the pressure cooker, and I'm going to place it before or after hot air balloon. I think the pressure cooker was invented after the hot air balloon. Once I have definitively placed my card with the date side down, I turn over my card. Oh, 1679. I was wrong. Here's what happens when you're wrong. You take your card, you place it in the discard pile, and you take the top card of the draw deck. Now I still have 5 cards I need to put into the timeline. Had I placed this card successfully, I say the pressure cooker, it was before the hot air balloon. I turn it over, and now it's correct. That stays in the timeline, and I have successfully placed one of my 5 cards. Players will have more trouble finding, well, where does my item, where does my invention go? It can now go in between hot air balloon and the pressure cooker. It can go before the pressure cooker, or it can go after the hot air balloon. So the next player in turn order is going to take one of their 5 cards, and now they have 3 places to put their cards successfully. If they are successful, the next player has 4 different places that they're going to be able to put their card. And so things are going to get more and more difficult and more challenging for students as they go. But the thing about this game that makes it so great is not only are you learning about things historically, you are learning dates and information about, in this case, inventions. You are also placing all of that information into context. Context is something I try to teach all of my students in every class that I have. Context is the big picture. If students are able to see the big picture, they can understand why things happened, how things happened, and why we should care about it. It's such an important and valuable idea for students to know and learn about. One of the things I value about Timeline is how scalable it is. You can play this with 2 people, you can play this with 8 people. They find this engaging, fun, interactive. It's a great opportunity to engage your students in that hands-on learning. And again, you are teaching them context in a way that I think sinks in a whole lot easier than learning rote facts and information. Timeline is a great team activity as well, each member contributing equally to successfully placing their cards. For a more rigorous and focused Timeline experience, have students state a more informed historical fact about the card they play when they play it. For example, if you're teaching American history, get the Americana pack of Timeline. If the card states Abe Lincoln elected president, they can't just say his name was Abe Lincoln or that he was president, but they can say he was the 16th president during the Civil War or that he was assassinated. I hope you enjoyed learning about Timeline and how versatile that game can be. This is another game called Cardline, and this is great for geography in addition to history and context. It functions in the same way, where you have a card and you are supposed to place the card that you have before or after this particular card in the center, but there are 4 different characteristics that you can gauge that context on. Just like before in Timeline, the top part of the card doesn't reveal any of that factual information. If you flip it over on the other side, you're going to see each of those 4 categories represented with a numerical value. So it's important to make sure all of your cards have that information face down. At the beginning of a game of Cardline, players will decide which category they are gauging their cards in, which means you choose square mileage. So if I play Thailand out in the center, I turn it over, this is our start card, and it says that Thailand is 198,456 square miles. And you look at your cards and you say, well, I can choose any of my countries and I can say in square miles it's smaller than Thailand or it's larger than Thailand. And the game will continue like that until one player has put all of their cards into the center card line. You can play this again immediately, shuffle up the cards, and then just pick another category like gross domestic product or CO2 emissions. The cards teach students about a landmark in that particular country. For example, this card is Israel and it shows the Wailing Wall. It also represents the flag of that country in the corner. I hope you enjoy Cardline as much as you enjoy Timeline. Hi students, Professor Kim here, and you are playing Timeline today. This is a fantastic game to explore and learn more about history and to learn how to put things into context. That's the big picture. It helps because we can learn more about individual items when we learn about the relationship to other items around them. By the end of the game, you should have a really long timeline on the table that all of you have created with your individual cards. Let's jump into how to play. Setup for Timeline is pretty easy. There's one really important thing you should make sure you follow as you unpack the game, and that is only look at the top of the cards so that you do not see the dates on the cards. Make sure you keep that date side face down. Depending on the amount of players, everyone will receive 4, 5, or 6 of those cards. with the date side down. They're going to place that in front of them in their player area, and then one person will take the top card from the draw pile, flip it over, and now you can see there's that date I was talking about. It's a bright colored date in a flag. This one says garbage bags were invented in 1950. That's going to be our starting point for the timeline. Now, starting with player one, they're going to look at all of the cards they have in front of them. They can choose any of the five, in my case, because I'm playing a four-player game, and they will take that card and place it in front of garbage bags or after garbage bags, which means I think my invention happened before 1950 or after 1950. For example, I might place the bicycle in front of garbage bags. Once I've placed my card physically in the place I think it goes in the timeline, I turn it over to see if I'm right. 1817, I was right. That means that now I only have four more cards to place into the timeline successfully. Play will continue to the next player, but now, as you've noticed, they have three choices for where to put their card. Before 1817 with the bicycle, in between the bicycle and garbage bags, or after garbage bags. So as every player successfully places a card into the timeline is going to grow and get bigger and bigger, and your choices are going to become more challenging and more complex, which requires you to really critically think about where my particular invention goes. Contextualizing all of that information is what this game is all about. Let's take a closer look at some of these cards and check out our timeline. Since player one just went and they successfully placed their bicycle, it's up to player two now to place one of their cards into the timeline. They're going to place dynamite in front of the bicycle. 1867. Oh no, they were wrong. Here's what happens when you incorrectly place a card. You take it, put it in the discard pile, and then draw a new card. So this player still has five cards they need to place successfully into the timeline. Player three is gonna go. They're pretty sure the role-playing games, since they play, go after garbage bags. 1974, that's successful. Our timeline is getting a little bit bigger. And now again, they only have four more cards to place. So player four will go next. They're gonna say the pencil came before the bicycle, and they're correct, but only by a couple years. Play comes back around to player one. This is going to continue until one player has placed their last card successfully and everyone has had an equal number of turns. If there's a tie, the tied players will draw the top card from the draw deck and place it into the timeline. If they're successful and their opponents are not, they break the tie and win the game. If two inventions have the same exact date, they are considered in the same spot. Okay, it's time for some tips and suggestions. First thing, take a look at your cards in the very beginning of the game and try to figure out which ones you think you're more confident about date-wise than the other cards. And I would try to play those challenging or nebulous dates for you earlier in the game when there are fewer choices of where to put your card. Remember, in the beginning, you either have before or after the starting timeline card, and then it just continues to grow and you have more and more options, which makes it a little bit more challenging to fit in those dates that are really close to other events. Next, don't be discouraged if you mess up. If you put a card in a place and you were way off, maybe you were even just a year or two off, don't worry about it. Put that in the discard pile, grab a new card, you'll get it next time. Pay attention while other people are placing their inventions. When they flip the card, you're going to learn when that thing happened, even if they were right or wrong about it, which gives you more information to place your card successfully. Lastly, think about that context. Think about the big picture. Try to assess when you think your particular card happened in time. Is it an early event, meaning BC, or is it an event that happened in this century, the previous century, and so forth. Try to just get it in the ballpark and then look at the timeline and figure out where you think most likely it would fit. I hope you enjoy Timeline and I hope you have a great time with it. Thank you for watching this video. I hope you learned a lot about the game and also how to bring it into your classroom successfully. One of the things I would like to suggest is that maybe at a later date, in a week or two or three, bring this game back into your classroom and you're going to find that your students are really excited to jump in and play the game because they know the rules and they feel more confident playing. You also will get successful returns when you bring the game back. Again, students just feel confident. They kind of relax a little. They have a little bit more fun. And if there's a student that missed the first day, you will find that all of your students become teachers at that point. They are so excited to share this knowledge about how to play this game with their fellow students. And you could honestly ask for nothing more than having your students learn something, internalize it, have fun with it, and then share it with someone else. Thank you again for watching. You'll find helpful information below with links and suggestions and other helpful advice and information that I include in this video.